Hey everybody. So yeah, I wanted to share some principles with you as it is Wednesday, and I tried to give you guys some encouraging words or some things that's going to challenge you in your spiritual journey that's going to help you live the balanced life. And I pray thus far that you guys are enjoying Steady Girl and just having an awesome time just watching how I go through life, watching how I handle different things, and just seeing how I try to balance life the best way I know how. And I'm always learning. This is definitely sometimes it's a trial and error period, because when you do new things and you walk through new doors of opportunity, those can have a direct impact on your schedule and on the things that you need to do to keep everything in balance. So yeah, so don't be too hard on yourself, but always know that you can do it. Why? Because God has given you the strength, and you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. So always be encouraged. The balanced life is not about being perfect at everything. And I'm going to talk about that just a little bit. It's not about being perfect in everything, but really thriving off of your strengths and not your weaknesses. And so it's just really, really important that you really understand that God has given you gifts, and He's given you talents, and He is also giving you grace to do things that you were not necessarily trained in, or that you didn't necessarily see yourself doing. I know for me, for example, when I graduated undergrad, I thought I was just going to go right into full-time ministry, which I did. But I also had to do some other things because I was entering into the family business, right? And so I had been a part of the church, my dad's church, all my life, and I really, really love Prevailing Church. And so I was just excited to just get my hands wet and to really be in the trenches. And so after I graduated undergrad, I came here to work for the church, which is really exciting because as I look back from where we started, let's see, that was 2012. So, oh my gosh, was it nine, almost 9 years ago? So yeah, almost 9 years ago. And remembering how I started with my little stipend check in my little office, and just how see how God has just elevated the church. And because I was committed to kingdom work, God has also elevated me. And so I'm super grateful for the opportunity. And you know what? That was just a, can we just pause right there? Because sometimes you need to pause and take a moment to look back on where God has brought you from, and then you'll see the significance of the growth. I mean, just to see how far the administrative side of Prevailing Church has come within the past 9 years, not because of me, but when I tell you it's literally because of God's grace and His mercy that I can honestly say, like, wow. And this is like being really transparent as I'm sharing this with you today. Like, wow, I'm just realizing, like, wow, we have come so far. And I remember during one of our youth and young adult conferences, my big brother, who had came to minister, laid hands on me. He said that God was going to give me another grace for administration, basically because I had to fill in the gaps, and my parents needed me to fill in the gaps. So not only was I going to become the youth minister, but I needed to work in full-time administration. Well, I don't know if I was too happy about that, that word when I received it, but I received it because the Lord immediately told me that He was making me into a really well-rounded pastor, that that I was just not going to have the privilege of ministering and preaching and teaching the gospel and lesson planning and all of that, but that I was going to have an opportunity to also learn the inner workings on how to run a ministry, from cleaning bathrooms to learning how to do payroll to organizational leadership to I don't know what you want it to. Running a staff, to learning the business side of ministry, to doing leadership training and manuals, and then to be elevated to be a pastor. And I mean, it's just everything. And then to go on and get my master's in global ministry. I mean, like you wouldn't have told me that I would be here when I received that word several years ago. And so just understand and believe that God is going to give you the grace to handle things that you weren't necessarily prepared for. And I'm telling you, it is like a divine intervention, y'all. Like, it's a divine intervention. And so never panic. God, I thank you. Never panic where God has called you to do something that seems so much bigger than yourself. Never, ever, ever panic. Why? Because you have yet to tap into the supernatural grace and the power of God for the call that is on your life. Yes, God prepares you and he gives you visions. And I know for me, and I can only testify what happened for me. I have a type A personality. So I am organized. I'm a list person. Stuff does have to add up on paper for me. I'm like, but what are the facts? And sometimes that type of personality can be a detriment to your faith. And a lot of times you have to factor yourself out so that you can allow faith to work and do what it's supposed to do, which, as Apostle Hilliard says, is tap into the creative power of God that's made available to you, where you can transfer situations and circumstances in the realm that you live in over which you have been given authority. So that is faith. And so a lot of times you have to factor yourself out, get rid of that personality, and watch God work through your life. And so to just watch his divine intervention in my daily work and in my daily operations as the COO of Prevailing Church is just amazing. Some of the things that, now that I look back on and see where we are today, some of the things that I had put in place and just the knowledge and trying to build up a firm foundation so that we can keep growing, I had no intention to do. I would just walk into the church one day and look at my project board, which was then on notebook paper. Okay, didn't know nothing about no digital or nothing. But since then, things have come out in the last 9 years, right? And looking like, okay, we need to work on this area. We need to work on that area. And we need to do this. And realizing, I don't know why I just automatically wanted to do it, but that was the gift of the Holy Spirit. Not knowing that God was trying to put us in a position for opportunities to happen, for doors to open. So watch God work, obey God, and be confident in knowing that he's going to give you everything you need if you just get out there and get started. So for today, really quickly, I'm just going to share some quick principles with you that I have learned about leadership, especially as a PK, someone that has the anointing of God on their lives from their parents. I mean, this is a generational anointing that I'm walking in. I don't take it lightly. And I'm definitely taking it to the next level, because that's what we're supposed to do. My dad did not, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, and I think my great-great-grandfather did not work this hard for the legacy to die with our generation, me, Matthew, and Sean, and to die with us, but it's to take it to another level and to expand it so that we can keep enhancing the kingdom of God. So it's just, I mean, I'm just excited. So one of the things I've learned about leadership is, and I try to do some of my devotionals on leadership. Again, this is about balance. I have days where I focus on my personal life. I have days where I focus on pastoring and leadership. And then I have days where I have other devotionals where I focus on being a good wife. I have other ones that I'm in now that's focusing on our pregnancy journey, just to keep my faith and to feed my faith in different areas of my life so that nothing goes lacking. And that's what I do. You don't have to do that, but that's what I do. And it thus far, it has really, really worked for me. So one of the things that I love about spiritual leadership is that, first of all, it's just a blessing that, first of all, God chose me to lead a group of people. Hello. God chose me to lead a group of people. Like, are you serious? Little old me, the person that used to struggle with self-esteem, a person that definitely didn't think that they were qualified or worth anything. And to really think that, why would people listen to me? I mean, I don't know what was going on with my life, but I had friends, but at the end of the day, I had people that really didn't like me. I don't know why, because I feel like I'm a nice person. I'm a friendly person, but I don't know if they were scared of me or they just saw greatness on the inside of me or whatever. But I love people. I love people. And that's really growth, because I was a really true introvert. But you can't do God's business and not like his people. So I asked God to give me another passion for his people. So yeah. And so just the fact that he chose me to lead a group of people and to really just minister across the world is just astonishing to me. But spiritual leadership, and one of the things I have read and I want to share with you today, and a good person to study about if you're looking to enhance your leadership qualities and character, is studying King Solomon. I mean his life is an open book, all right, in the Word of God. You can read about King Solomon in 1 Kings. I would start maybe around chapter 8 and go all the way through to like 12, and just maybe do some backward, even going before then, to study his father, because he inherited some amazing things, and the only reason why he was successful, and I hope you guys are hearing me, is because the work of his father. Even some of the things that he was able to accomplish was because David was the man after God's own heart. And even when Solomon disobeyed and didn't do things that he was supposed to do, God still honored his promise to David. So therefore, Solomon was able to reap off of his father's service. So I hope y'all are hearing me, that no matter, especially to my PKs, no matter how much your fathers, your mothers, or whatever may get on your nerves, because they are our parents, but at the end of the day, there's some generational blessings that we should not be entitled to, but that we receive because of our parents' faithfulness to the kingdom of God and to God alone. So just some things that I want to encourage you as you are balancing, and as you are, taking this thing to another level. I want you to be sure, and I want you to know that the devil is on assignment, and his main job is to steal, kill, and to destroy. Remember that, to steal, kill, and to destroy. He doesn't want you to answer the call of God that's on your life. He doesn't want you to be successful in ministry. He doesn't want you to be successful in anything, let alone anything that has to do with God. And so, you ever been in a season where you're sinning and it looks like that you're thriving, and it's only for a season because you know the hand of the Lord is still on your life, and when you are out of the will of God, it only lasts for a season? Well, that's because the devil is excited because you're far away from God. But listen, sin only lasts, it only feels good for a moment, and then you realize that you are empty. You have, you know, God's hand. In some cases, he might have removed himself from your life or removed his hand, and thank God for the grace of the Lord, because there have been plenty of opportunities that could have happened to me. But I'm telling you that you just need to know that the enemy is on assignment, and the Bible says that he literally is seeking throughout the earth. And I think one translation talks about how he has arrows with your name on it. So how I explain it to my young people is that he's an assassin. Like, you ever watch the movies where they hire the assassins, you know, and you know, like something like Jason Bourne or somebody, somebody got your name, okay, and they coming to get you in the midnight hour, and you'll sleep, okay? They come in silently too, silent killers. So you have to be aware that the enemy is coming to steal, kill, and to destroy. And one of those things that he wants you to do, one of the ways he's trying to do that is by distracting you. That's a really simple way. So now that you know how he's coming and you know his hand, you can prepare for that and put things in place so that when these stumbling blocks come, or when the trials and tribulations and all these different things come in your way, you will be prepared for that. And so I just want to encourage you really quickly. So if you look at the life of Solomon, he was living it up, y'all. Like, the wisest king of the biblical days. Like, the bomb. Like, people were coming from all over the world, sitting at his feet, learning the knowledge and in astonishment of the kingdom that he built. He was wealthy, he was balling, and he was good looking, okay? All right, so he was the bomb, all right? And so in today's time, he would probably be, you know, the most richest person in the world, billionaire, own jets, all that, Fortune 500 companies, so on and so forth, okay? So he was balling. People are amazed at his growth and his success. So, but one of the things that we have to understand, that even all these gifts, all these anointing and all these things that Solomon had, he also fell to sin, and he also got distracted, and because God had blessed him so richly, he got caught up in himself and he failed, okay? The good thing is by the grace of God, and once again, because God made a promise to David, God allowed for King Solomon to keep his kingdom until the day he died. But after that, his son reaped the bad things that his dad did during his lifetime. And so be careful what you're doing, and be careful not to stumble, and be careful the decisions that you make, because it just does not affect you. It affects generations to come. And you know, you have to make sure that, you know, distractions can derail generational anointing that is assigned to your family. So when you're going out and making these decisions, and you want to make decisions that are geared toward fleshly desires, or that may seem more appealing, be careful that your children and your children's children inheritance is on the line. So hopefully that'll give some weight to your decision making. So let's look at the process of decay for leaders, and how Solomon went through that. Number one, we have distractions, right? It's the deviation from the call. You're gonna have distractions in life. Guys, we could drive and we'll find distractions. We see people walking. We see people on the side. You may see something. I know when I drive and I pass a house that's like, oh, that's it right there. I am distracted from what's in front of me. So it is a natural thing to be distracted when you were on a road and when you were on your way to a destination. But just like when you are driving, you cannot keep looking to the side and you cannot keep turning your head when you hear something or something has caught your attention. You have to stay focused, y'all. Y'all gotta stay focused. And so remember that you are on your way to a destination. And I just want to encourage you guys that you know how to do it because you're driving. So you have already been trained. Thank you, Lord. You have already been trained, y'all. Already been trained on how to ignore distractions. So that same type of training that you went through driver school and that you went through, you know, all driving your tests and different things, the same type of discipline and patience that you practice during driving is the same skills that you have to apply to your life. Stay focused. Don't allow things to distract. I know it's easier said than done because your girl gets distracted, but you got to constantly remind yourself. And that's why you got to have things near you to kind of speak into your life, speak in faith. You got to have checklists. You got to have checks and balances, things that will help bring your mind back to things that you're working on and things that God has called you to do. Number two, you got some adversaries. We're talking about the process of decay. You have some adversaries. And when we're thinking about King Solomon, God had raised up people. God had raised up people to steer him back to his priorities. So what does that mean? In other words, God will raise up adversaries to give you a wake-up call, boo. And to let you know that you weren't as successful as you thought you were. That there are some people that are trying to take your position out here in these streets, okay? There are some people that are waiting for your demise. And there are some people out there that are literally waiting for you to fall and to stumble so that they can gain your inheritance, your blessing, and the call because they want your life so bad. All right. So don't let them win, y'all. Don't let them win. And some of them, the Bible says that God raised up people to try to get Solomon's attention. I mean, and we're going back generations. Some of the people that God was raising up were people from David's time. And so you have to understand that this thing is so much bigger than you. And that you were, hate to say this, but you're not indispensable. Like, God, you can be replaced. Like, you can be replaced, and God can give your calling, your giftings, and your anointing to someone else. So never take it for granted. Once again, count it as a privilege, count it as a blessing, because there's somebody else that's waiting to take your spot. And guess what? God's not waiting for you. Yeah, he's not waiting for you. At the end of the day, God has an agenda, okay? And he's not about to wait for someone to get their whole life together. So someone that has already experienced a modicum of success, and then now you blow it because of your fleshly desires, and now he's supposed to wait another 20 years for you to get your whole life together? No, there's people out there that need to be saved, healed, delivered, and set free. So, no, boo. His agenda is the people of God, and his people of God are way more important than your fleshly desires. So get it together. And as I'm talking to y'all, I'm literally preaching to myself. All right. Not preaching, but preaching to myself. All right. And then, okay, so we have distractions. We got adversaries. Then you got self-absorption. Self-absorption, when you become consumed with yourself rather than the call of God. And I hate to say this, y'all, but a lot of times it comes because you become successful. So you got the money, you got the power, you got the authority, you have, I don't know, let's just name some material things. You got the big house, you got the cars, you got the people, you got everything. And all of a sudden you become so prideful and you become full of yourself. Baby girl, bull, sit yourself all the way down. And I'm talking like this because this is how I talk to yourself. Like, sit your happy self all the way down. At the end of the day, the reason why you have what you have, number one, is because of God. Number two, is not because of your success. It's because of the inheritance, the promise that God promised to your parents. So you did not make it all this way on your own. All right. You literally had a foundation that was presented to you that you were able to build upon. All right. So sit down all the way. I feel like, baby girl. Okay. You hear me? All right. So don't become so consumed with yourself, and don't be prideful. All right. God loves the humble. In pride, God hates prideful people. And so you have to understand that you didn't get this far by yourself. God saved you. And the only reason why you are successful is because of him. Is because of him. I mean, it's because of him every day. Like, I check myself. I check my spirit. I check everything. And you can honestly ask my parents. Like, I have to check myself, like, so that I don't become jealous, so that I don't allow things that are not of God to seep into my spirit that will allow me to have the spirit of comparison. I do not allow that. And there's some things that people will say, I'm like, don't say that, because I don't want it to come into my spirit, because I need to make sure that my heart remains pure. So don't become so full of yourself, all right? You don't know everything. Yeah, you don't know everything. And here's the thing. God had sent people, God, I thank you, and had given Solomon words of warnings several times. Even if you go back in just those small amount of passages or chapters, you will see it. He says, and you must obey. But if your people do not listen to me, I mean, he says it on countless times, and he keeps reiterating. Why? Because God is knowing, God knows all things. And obviously he saw something in the future where the life and the glitz and the glam of your success were going to try to take over, and you forget about who you serve and who you worship. So self-absorption. Then what's next on the decay process? You have the loss of God's presence. Yo, it's when God withdraws his anointing and his hand from your life and you literally feel a void. I have been there, y'all. When I was so caught up in a season where I wanted to do what I wanted to do. And when I tell you, when you feel like your life is void of God's presence, that is a dangerous place to be. And honestly, I went into a mad depression, because it is like an emptiness that you do not want to feel. And I'm talking from personal experience, like to not be able to hear, to not to be able to worship freely, and to literally feel so down, as my dad would say, there's no place to go but up. Like, sin will have you out here thinking crazy stuff until you come to a place like, oh snap, like I can't do this on my own. Like, the people I thought were for me are not for me. The people that I thought, you know, have my back are not there to have my back. And to realize that God is raising up adversaries, like trying to, you know, take me down, like, yeah, it's real out here in these streets. So don't get this far. So you got distractions, and then you have adversaries, and then you have self-absorption, then you got the loss of God's presence. Number five, then you have the pursuit of pleasure. Okay, we're talking about the decay process of leaders, and for those of us who are trying to live a life patterned after God. Okay, so you become even more obsessed with your own pleasure. Like, so not only do you go past of losing God's presence, but now you're so wrapped up in yourself. And I hope you guys are seeing the process. I hope you guys are seeing how the devil is playing straight up game on y'all. Like, straight up game. He then sunk his teeth into y'all, and literally he is dangling y'all like a puppet. Like, seriously, he has manipulated you so bad that now you are his own puppet, and you are so caught up in yourself that you don't even know what's real and what's fake. And you are literally living a fake dream. Like, you're living, like, it's just crazy. And yeah, it's just not a good place to be. So don't become obsessed with yourself. Remember, at the end of the day, it's not about you, but it's about God. All right. And then we have emptiness, is where you grow weary of the pursuit, and you recognize your own emptiness. And that sometimes people have to get so low to that point, because that's like your rock bottom. That's where God is like, I've had enough. Like, the only way he coming back is if you get on your hands and your knees and you repent to the Lord. And yeah. And you pray that today he wants to activate his grace and his mercy. Like, he does it every day. New grace and mercies we see. But listen, don't take God's grace and his mercy for granted. It is not a license to keep on sinning. Because at the end of the day, you will suffer the consequences of the decisions that you make. And it may not affect you, but it affects generations to come, just like King Solomon. So, yeah. So just, I hope that you are empowered today. Yo, don't let these things happen to you as you are leaders. Okay, y'all? Like, don't let it happen. I have went over my time. This was only supposed to be a 15-minute thing. It has ended up being 25 minutes. So I hope y'all enjoyed that. All right, so don't allow distractions. Don't let God raise up some adversaries. Don't be self-absorbed. Don't lose God's presence. Don't lose the pursuit of, don't get into the pursuit of your own pleasure, and definitely don't get to the place where you feel totally empty.
Listen, I hope that you were blessed and
that you were encouraged by those principles that I share with you today. But listen, I just need you guys to do something for me. Can you go and please subscribe to the Steady Girl YouTube channel? All right, go and subscribe, enjoy the other episodes that have already premiered, and listen, follow us, but most importantly, go and subscribe so I can feel you guys' support. All right, that's all I have for you today. I want y'all to keep your heads up, keep it steady, and keep on living for God. Love you. See you next time.